Welcome to the American Heart Association Statements and Guidelines Podcast, where we'll discuss clinical practice guidelines and scientific statements on various cardiovascular disease and stroke topics.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Brian Hoh, and I'm a neurosurgeon and the chair of the Department of Neurosurgery at the University of Florida. And I had the great privilege of being the chair of the writing group for these American Heart Association and American Stroke Association updated guidelines for treating patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage.
And my name is Narissa Ko. I'm a neurointensivist and vascular neurologist, and I'm the vice chair for neurology in the Department of Neurology at the University of California, San Francisco. I also had the privilege of working with Dr. Hoh as the vice chair for the writing group responsible for the updated guidelines on aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage.
We are continuing our discussion of the AHA-ASA updated guidelines for treating patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. If you haven't listened to the first episode yet, you want to start there, but we're going to pick up right now where we left off.
We left off at the initial evaluation of patients with suspected aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. Once that evaluation is completed, then it's time to move into definitive diagnosis of the source of bleeding. CT scan is often the first step. How do we decide if a CT scan is appropriate? It's our recommendation that if a patient presents with a severe headache and any new neurologic deficit within 6 hours, then a CT scan is the most sensitive test. If the patient does have evidence of blood in the subarachnoid space, then we can use imaging studies such as a CT angiogram or a digital subtraction angiogram to look for the source of bleeding. These types of tests will give you a better idea of the aneurysm location and morphology and look for the source of hemorrhage.
If CTA is negative or inconclusive, then DSA is the gold standard. It is a class 1 highest recommendation to use DSA to determine the location of the aneurysm, its shape, the essential things to know before deciding on the best treatment if the CTA is negative or insufficient. Once you have that information, you can decide on how to go about obliterating the aneurysm. There's clipping, coiling, flow diversion, and stent-assisted coiling. We have a formula for which strategy is best that depends on location of the aneurysm, anterior or posterior circulation, the type of aneurysm, wide neck, fusiform, or saccular, and the age of the patient. And the recommendations about which procedure to use based on the conditions of the aneurysm vary in confidence level. For example, for anterior circulation location, we have a class 1 recommendation that coiling is better than clipping for 1-year outcomes. However, for patients under the age of 40, we have a class 2, so a little weaker recommendation that clipping is preferred. For the surgery itself, we have some guidelines. None of these are class 1 recommendations with the strongest possible evidence, but they're still worth considering. Mannitol and or hypertonic saline can be effective in reducing intracranial pressure and cerebral edema. You want to prevent hyper and hypoglycemia during aneurysm surgery. As we said earlier, blood pressure is important. Blood pressure monitoring and control is a good thing to continue during surgery. Adenosine may be considered to induce cardiac standstill to help with aneurysm clip placement. Our one don't recommendation is in good grade aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, induced mild hypothermia during aneurysm surgery is not beneficial.
Now that you've hopefully obliterated the aneurysm and reduced the risk of rebleeding, you're not out of the woods yet. As we think about patients who've had an aneurysm rupture, often we think about the early brain injury and addressing those important things in the first 72 hours. What happens during the hemorrhage is that the blood gets into the outside coverings of the brain and becomes very irritating to the brain tissue, as well as the blood vessels that live in this space. There's also a possibility of medical complications that can arise in the days subsequent to the aneurysm rupture, and we call this the secondary or delayed brain injury. Some of the things that we should be prepared to treat and avoid if possible are around hydration and fluid balance. Hyponatremia is also very, very common, and it's important to watch for imbalances of fluids and electrolytes. Sodium balance is something you want to have in mind constantly. And maintaining euvolemia is the most important recommendation to improving outcomes. In addition, the patients are also at risk for common things in the neurointensive care unit, including venous thromboembolism. We have a class one strongest recommendation to use prophylactic treatment, either mechanical or pharmacological, to prevent venous thromboembolism. Even in the case of a hemorrhagic injury like subarachnoid hemorrhage, it's important to initiate these types of measures to prevent a known complication.
Acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS, is lethal. It occurs in about 4% of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage patients within 7 days. It's most common in patients who were unhealthy before they arrived to the ICU, and nurses should be watching for it all the time. And this recommendation about ARDS was particularly relevant during the COVID-19 pandemic. During that time, I personally took care of many patients who had aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage and had COVID-19 and developed severe ARDS. And because of standardized protocols in taking care of these patients with severe ARDS, even including putting these patients prone, was so important in taking care of these complex and very sick patients.
One of the most challenging things to manage in patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage is optimizing their volume and electrolyte status. While maintaining euvolemia is the most important goal, achieving this is often difficult, and using more monitoring tools to assess volume status is important for managing these patients. We do know that hypervolemia, or increased volume, is not recommended and associated with excess morbidity in these patients. Similarly, hyponatremia is so common, and monitoring sodium and electrolytes together on a routine basis will help avoid making this a complication, and treating it early is also important in improving the patient's overall outcome. The hyponatremia after subarachnoid hemorrhage can be quite profound and require repletion that is extraordinarily high compared to our medical intensive care patient population. In cases like this, I've often used a combination of hypertonic saline, sometimes up to 100 cc's an hour, additional salt tablets per nutritional support, as well as fludrocortisone and other mineralocorticoids to support aggressive salt wasting in patients.
Fever. We should watch for fever and prevent it. And cardiac arrest and heart conditions can occur here due to lingering problems in the brain. And protein malnutrition is a risk if patients can't eat, so we should be monitoring for this.
Some patients will arrive to the intensive care unit without the ability to manage their airways and will require emergency intubation and ventilatory support. In cases when patients are this critically ill, following standard protocols of monitoring and weaning ventilator support and standard nursing protocols are really important to help the patients recover in a timely manner. In addition, standard use of antibiotics to prevent infections like pneumonia and managing nutritional support is really critical for the recovery of these patients after their illness. For patients who are in a coma after subarachnoid hemorrhage, this is an area of emerging science, and we have a new class 2 recommendation, so a mild recommendation, but something that is definitely emerging as in the science of coma recovery, is to trial neurostimulants early on in their course to see if they can improve their mental status and help them wake up and return to consciousness earlier.
Seizures are another big risk for aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage patients, and we have some important recommendations in this area. First, it's important to know what makes a patient more at risk for seizure. fluctuating neurological exam and depressed mental state, ruptured MCA aneurysm, high-grade subarachnoid hemorrhage, presence of intracerebral hemorrhage, hydrocephalus or cortical infarction. For these patients, continuous EEG can be a good idea to monitor for possible seizures.
That being said, we need to be careful with prophylactic or anti-seizure medications. This guideline reviews the most current literature available in use of prophylactic or preventative medicines. We should not use anti-seizure medicines in all patients, but only consider in patients who have higher risk for seizures. In particular, the use of phenytoin is not recommended because it's been associated with worse outcomes after aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. If a patient has actual clinical seizures at the time of the hemorrhage, then we would want to treat those patients with anti-seizure medicines for 7 days. Treating patients with no prior history of epilepsy and no high-risk features for longer than 7 days was shown to have no benefit. If a patient has seizures in a delayed fashion during the recovery from a hemorrhage, then that's a different story. In this case, we would treat with anti-seizure medication similar to in other scenarios for a longer course of treatment beyond 7 days. This is a new way of approach to seizures, as we used to treat all seizures in a similar vein, and now we would want to really think about, are these seizures actually happening as a result of an acute reversible injury? Are they a prodrome to more chronic seizure disorder because of acquired brain injury? And more, less use of preventative seizure medication when there's no seizures at all.
Okay, so now that we've gone through aneurysm treatment and some of the likely complications, in the next episode, we're going to go deeper into recovery and spend a lot of time talking about some of the most important secondary sequelae of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, such as hydrocephalus, vasospasm, and delayed cerebral ischemia.
Be sure not to miss this next episode, because as we've said, aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage is a serious condition and not only important to treat the early brain injury, but equally important to treat the secondary brain injury and even help patients achieve their best recovery after the hospital stay.
Data and statistics presented in this podcast are from the official guideline being released by the American Heart Association. Any and all personal stories and testimonies are that of the talent, host, and volunteers, and are not reflective of any statements or position of the American Heart Association. For a full manuscript of the guideline released, please visit the official American Heart Association website at professional.heart.org.